Welcome back, guys. It's the dude, back with another informational video. This is going to be a long video because I'm going to be explaining the ancestral skills and combos I take as a mage and why I prefer one over the other, as well as matchups in PvP and positioning. Remember, guys, this is my opinion, so take it for what it's worth. During the time of this recording, I'm playing on Legacy Patch 5.5. I'll also be explaining changes in 6.0 as I see fit. I'll timestamp each of the topic of discussion in the description down below. So without further ado, let's recast. As a DPS mage, I want to be able to maximize my damage output as much as possible. When played correctly, mages have a good amount of burst damage. Now, don't mindlessly use all of your skills and put them on cooldown, because sometimes having an ability on standby can be much scarier than actually using it. That's if your opponent understands mages. When it comes to PvP, whether it's 1v1s or open world, your skill setups are very situational. 1v1 builds are sometimes not good for group PvP and vice versa. So understanding your class and capabilities, as well as your enemies, should really determine what you need to run in those types of situations. Let's take a look at our Manabolts and Flamebolts. Now, I take basic Manabolts. You can opt for the wave Manabolts for the moves you proc, but I don't think it's necessary. The basic Manabolts just deals more damage. Basic Manabolts shoots out 4 basic bolts and then 1 hard-hitting bolt, whereas the wave Manabolts shoots out 3 basic bolts and 1 hard-hitting bolt. And when it comes to quake Manabolts, don't even consider it. I take lightning Flamebolts as of patch 5.5. It allows me to DPS while on the move. Although I do take basic Flamebolt from time to time, it's not something I would consider until 6.0. The damage between the two are drastically noticeable, but being mobile is key. Now, if you run Shadow Play and use Backdrop, it cancels the cast time for Flamebolts. In 6.0, you will be able to weave Lightning God's Whip with either the hard cast Flamebolts. The most common take on this with green players in 6.0 are either backdrop into basic Flamebolts and lightning God's Whip, or backdrop into flame Flamebolt and lightning God's Whip. Key bindings are very essential for this combo. Now, focus on animation timing in this clip. This is the combo I use with both Flamebolts and Manabolts. It's a good combo for consistent damage and if your backdrop is on cooldown. I also consider this as an animation cancel. All of the DPS skills and Sorcery combos off of each other. I highly recommend reading the combo tips on each of the skills to maximize your damage output. We will talk about the skills from top to bottom and left to right. Freezing Arrow is a good skill for early game in both PvP and PvE. It slows an enemy on hit, and if you use the skill with Frigid Checks, it eliminates Freezing Arrow's cast time and deep freezes the enemy. This skill grants you a bubble for 40 seconds and absorbs X amount of damage based on the grade and tier of your armor. It also grants immunity to trip, and upon breaking, it snares all enemies within a 6-meter radius from you. With the 4th passive and sorcery, Mana Fountain, it also grants you 100 attack speed, 15% decreased cast time, and will last between 20 to 60 seconds whenever you use 3 of the skills in a passive description. This is a stack. I always use this skill in arenas and open world PvP when I remember to use it. Arc Lightning in the past has been a highly feared and very devastating skill for mages. In recent patches up until 6.0, players are opting out not to use this skill because of the damage nerfs. I use it from time to time whenever I can freely cast it. It has about a 2 second cast time and deals 30% more damage to burnt targets. But in 6.0, if you're able to electrocute, freeze, and burn a target, you'll be granted a 70% increase in crit damage for Arc Lightning, on top of the 30% damage increase when target is burned. This can potentially become a one-shot combo if you can land a crit strike and imbue your targets with electrocute, freeze, and burn. I run Magic Circle during group PvP and not so much in arenas until we get patch 6.0. Currently, Magic Circle grants 141 magic attack and 9% crit rate, plus the buff from Mana Fountain. In 6.0, you will be able to use the skill and run around up to 100 meters and instantly teleport back to your magic circle as long as there is nothing blocking the line of sight from the original placement of magic circle. I run the skill in both arenas and open world PvP, and occasionally I'll swap out this skill for Arc Lightning. Freezing Earth snares all enemies within an 8-meter radius for about 3 seconds. It's a great skill for holding down enemies and getting out of sticky situations. I use Flame Barrier for all cases. It draws a 20-meter wall in front of you for 10 seconds that slows, burns, and deals damage over time to all enemies who come in contact with it. Its burns effect grants 41% more damage on electrocuted targets. I didn't pay too much attention to the 6.0 ancestral skill for this, but one of the ancestral versions will allow you to cast it further from you. When you have Insulating Lens up, Chain Lightning grants a stun and a silence on an enemy. When Chain Lightning is off a cooldown and Insulating Lens still up, you can apply the same stun and silence effect a second time. In 6.0, we can expect to see players running Wave Chain Lightning to apply a freeze effect on targets for the Arc Lightning combo. But for me personally, I see this more as an arena skill than it is for open world PvP until we get the 6.0 patch. Searing Ring is an AoE skill that deals a lot of damage, but it is also very inconsistent. When using this skill, it grants immunity to all debuffs while channeling the damage. Don't confuse channeling with casting. This is a very good skill for frontline mages like Revenants. You can drop Flame Barrier, Wave God's Whip, and Searing Rain at the same time. Frigid Track is a highly used skill by mages to fight against melees in arenas. Most mages don't use this skill outside of arenas. I personally don't use this skill because it has a 1.7 cast time without the Frigid Track gems. But it leaves a trail behind your character for 9 seconds for anyone to step on, and freezes them in place for about 4 seconds without any confinement gems. And as mentioned before, this skill allows you to cast Freezing Arrow instantly, and if your enemy understands your mage gameplay, they'll probably wet out your Frigid Tracks. Meteor can have a lot of potential to do a lot of damage and grant enemies different types of effects. For instance, basic can grant trip and knock people back. Wave grants a deep freeze and hold them in place. Lightning grants a slow for attack speed and movement speed. I personally switch between the three skills based on the situation I'm given. I normally run lightning in arenas in 1v1 open world, and in group, depending on the situation, it'll either be basic or wave. Basic meteor can also be a bad skill if your CC mage is trying to hold people in place, so remember that. God's Whip is one of the few DPS skills I highly value from Sorcery. It just deals a lot of damage. In small scale, it's a mix between basic or lightning in 6.0 or wave. In Raver's Raid, I normally run wave 80% of the time for land PvP and 100% of the time for water PvP. And in 1v1s, it's definitely basic. Or in 6.0, I'll be running lightning God's Whip to utilize animation combos between God's Whip and Flamebolt for the maximum damage output. There isn't much to say about this other than it just deals a lot of damage. Now, rumor has it that there's a bug when using Wave God's Whip. Whenever an enemy has a battle pet summon, you deal additional God's Whip damage due to a bug that thinks that the battle pet is an actual player. Malediction tree scales really well with attack speed. The combos from here require usage of malice charges for maximum damage output. Each skill that uses mallet charges also have an enhanced effect based on how many charges it consumes. This tree is really good for bursty AoE damage. Serpent's Glare is a very good skill for group PvP. It turns your Manabolts into a death laser beam that shoots out red lasers out to 20 meters and deals damage to anyone in the line of sight. It grows through any physical barriers between you and the enemy, for example, boneyard, imprisoned, ships, walls, etc. This skill lasts for 16 seconds, and the duration will be further increased when you use Sunglow Malediction gems for your build. With my current build, I can use this skill every 10 to 15 seconds. In 6.0, we will receive the Ancestral skill for Serpent's Bite, and the one you should consider taking will be the Flame version. It reduces the number of charges needed to be consumed from 5 and 10 to 3 and 5. Both charges deals additional 200% more skill damage and deals an AoE damage within a 7-meter radius from the original target. For the last enhancement, it also petrifies the enemy, holding them in place for 2 seconds. You have to be very wary about using this skill because sometimes the animation and damage does not go off. Malice Binding is a great skill to cheese somebody in arenas or to hold someone down to drop damage on top of them in 1v1s or in group PvP. I don't take this because it's not needed for my gameplay. It has a very short cast time with a 10 meter cast range and will hold an enemy in place for 5 seconds. But this will still allow an enemy to move within a 5 meter radius. Melees can still charge and try to strike you within the means of the range of their skill. Fury is a very vital skill for Malediction users. It allows you to charge your Malice stacks with Manabolts to use the enhanced effect for each of the Malice consuming skills. It charges Malice stacks for 10 seconds and has a grace period of 5 seconds to cast all of your skills. If you use this correctly, you can get off all of your enhanced skills within a 15 second period, but do not use this mindlessly. This skill has a 30 second cooldown time, so make sure you're able to drop your Malice consuming skills. Soulbound Edge deals dot damage upon contact and will also decrease an enemy's defenses by 150 up to 15 times for 6 seconds. I used to use this skill back when I was trying out my hybrid build. It was a good means for negating magic defense, but when I was able to stack my base magic defense pin numbers, I no longer use this. Ghastly Pack is the unsung hero of the Malediction tree. Players overly underestimate the abilities of this skill. The initial skill does decent amount of damage in a 50 meter line of sight. At 5 charges, it shoots out 2 fat elephants parallel to each other out to 50 meters with no additional damage amplifier. At 10 stacks, it shoots out 2 fat elephants, knocks up all enemies it touches, canceling their castings and amplifying the damage by 100%. I'd say consider this in Raid vs Raid, and you'll see what I mean. There is also a new combo that uses this and Voice Surge in 6.0, but I'll explain that later in the video. Grasping Void is more of a meme than it is a skill. Although it has a long cast time, you can teleport yourself and your teammates up to 45 meters away. In 6.0, there will be an ancestral skill for this, and one of them allows you to teleport enemies on top of you. It might be great for frontline or CC mages, but I would have considered this for a DPS mage. Voice Surge will randomly teleport you 15 meters away from your current location and at the same time reduce your cooldowns by 50% for each enemy within a 5 meter radius from the spot you randomly teleported to. Now in 6.0, you can use this and within a 3 second period use Ghastly Pack. It will roll a dice above your head and give you a random number. That random number will determine how many Ghastly Pack you will shoot out of your Manabolts. Remember, Ghastly Pack does decent damage and shoots out 50 meters. This combo should be something to consider for group PvP. Ring Toss is a very good skill for all situations to cheese melees, mages, and healers alike. It disables the main hand for a short duration and can hit up to 3 additional targets within a 10 meter radius of each other. The 5 stack deals damage to 6 additional enemies, and a 10 stack is the same as a 5 stack with the addition of shackling the targets for 3 seconds. You can use this skill to cheese melees who jump on you, especially 2-handed melees, because it disables them completely from using any DPS related skills. For mages, you disable the main hand and drastically drop their damage output. Use this when you know you're going to get bursted by a mage. For healers, use this as a way to not allow them to heal themselves or the players around them. Now use this wisely for the big heals that healers can cast, for example, min and a disassist. Shadow Cloak is another cheese skill that is good for every situation. The initial skill allows you to become untargetable for 1 second. At 5 stack, it adds 3 seconds for a total of 4 seconds. At 10 stack, it adds 5 seconds for a total of 6 seconds. You can use this offensively or defensively depending on the matchup. I use this defensively against melees in most cases. Bladefall is the godswift of Malediction. Use Flame Bladefall over the others for the decreased Malediction stacks consumption. At 3 stacks, it drops 3 waves of blades and deals a decent amount of damage. At 5 stacks, it drops 4 waves of blades and impales the target for 1.5 seconds. When you use this, make sure the enemy isn't mobile because there is a delay in damage animation. For most melees, they are dumb enough to come flying at you in hopes to kill you. So if you have stacks, drop this on top of yourself and ring toss the melee. So he'll slap you with a wet needle or use Shadow Cloak and become untargetable and he'll receive all 4 blades and an impale. Trust me on this one. And before I end with Malediction, just know that with Malediction, whenever you have Fury up, you always want to use your Manabolts to stack up your Malice charges, so keep that in mind. Defiance is your get out of jail free card. It removes stun, trip, impale, fear, sleep, slow, shackle, silence, and confinement. It also grants immunities to those effects for 1 second. Although it resets upon death, in pre-6.0 patch, it has a 30-minute cooldown, but in 6.0, it is reduced down to 6 minutes. I primarily use this against melee trips and archer silence. As a mage in 1v1s, you have to understand your capabilities for the class you decide to play. Hesitation and anticipation can be a dangerous thought, so learn from your mistakes. Most melees will more than likely use all of their gap closing skills to try and get on top of you, so save all of your mobility skills as a mean of repositioning, and cheese them with what we just talked about in the video. For archers, their sole game plan is to shoot you from 30 meters away and come close below you to silence you. In open world, it is best to have a glider that can dive bomb or close the gap, or have a mount that can leap or have an invincible run and stun ability. When you can use this effectively to close the gap between you and the archer, it is over for them. You have to play more selfishly. As mages, we are squishy, especially if we get jumped on by two or more players. So play within your raid, near your healers or other mages, and free cast your abilities on balled up targets. At times, it can be very tempting to go lone wolf and pick off targets, but be aware of your surroundings and the cooldowns of your skills. Understand the geography of the map that you are on. Ask questions to yourself, like where is the Nui located? Are there guards around? Are there anything that enemy can use to their advantage? There's been numerous of times where I joined a pug raid to PvP at Diamond Shores, and my team would mindlessly run into the enemy canyons and get shelled or get Nui rushed because they get overzealous. Don't get me wrong, I'm guilty of this too. If and when you become able to contest for world bosses and in-game content, PvP becomes a little bit different. You have to come in with a different mindset, understanding when it is the right time to engage and disengage a fight, not chasing enemies into Africa, and what resources can you utilize around you. For example, using a world boss as bait or a means of DPS. The main thing for a mage in group PvP is to not die. Trauma timers can be the means of getting an objective done or wiping an enemy raid in a random group PvP, utilizing mounts and gliders for repositioning, getting out of bad situations, etc. Because at the end of the day, a good mage is a mage that stays alive. I hope you guys enjoyed this video. I made it one day before patch 6.0. I will be releasing a part 2 for this video for skill changes that I see worth mentioning. As always guys, if you like this video, make sure you like and subscribe and follow my Discord. I also want to thank you guys in my Discord for everything that you guys do, helping each other out with answering questions whenever I'm not around and providing information that I've missed. Until next time, don't let me freecast.